गुड आफ्टरनून सर.
वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून
विद्या वितर्क
विज्ञान. काशी है ना.
हर हर महादेव सर.
हर हर महादेव काशी के सिंबल है. कर लो
विद्या वितर्क विज्ञान. विद्या वितर्को विज्ञानम स्मृति तत्परता परम यस्य ते षड्गुणा तस्य न साध्यमति वर्तते. ए वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट हु जॉइंड अस फॉर द सेशन टुडे. माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर पूजा सेकेंड ईयर KCPG स्कॉलर फ्रॉम तारानाथ गवर्नमेंट आयुर्वेदिक मेडिकल कॉलेज बल्लारी. वेलकम्स यू ऑल. एम ईश्वर रेड्डी मेमोरियल काया चिकित्सा वेबिनार सीरीज 2021 ऑन द टॉपिक राजयक्ष्मा इन द मेमोरी ऑफ लेट श्रीनिवास आचार्य जी. We Taranath Government Ayurvedic Medical College and Hospital are blessed with Swargiya Pandit Taranath's name. As we know, Rajyakshma is a potential communicable disease with a high mortality rate, drug resistant, and the adverse drug reaction is one of the major cause for searching the alternate solution and understanding the concept of the vyadi. So keeping that in mind, on the occasion of World Tuberculosis Week, we Department of PG Studies in Kaya Chikitsa decided to conduct a webinar series. So welcome you all for the today's second session. And today our guest speaker, Dr. P.S. Radhi sir. It's my privilege to introduce you sir today. Sir had pursued his BMS degree from the Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya Hubli. Sir had pursued his MD in the Rog Nidana and the Vikriti Vijnana. Sir has done his PhD in the subject Kaya Chikitsa. Sir has attended as a resource person at many international and the national conferences and published more than 132 papers. Total book published by the sir, 11. Sir have achieved more than 14 awards and the special achievement too. Sir have more than 18 years experience in the field of Ayurveda. Sir's current posting with the position held professor and the HOD of Vikriti Vijnana faculty. We are blessed to have you sir today for our second webinar session on the topic critical understanding of the Rajyakshma from the current perspective.
हर हर महादेव.
हर हर महादेव.
रागादि रोगान सततान शक्तान अशेषकाय प्रसृतान अशेषान औत्सुक्य मोहारतिदान जघाना यो पूर्व वैद्याय नमस्ते तस्मै. ओम श्री धन्वंतरे नमः. विद प्रणामास टू लॉर्ड धन्वंतरे ऑल द ल्यूमिनरीज ऑफ आयुर्वेदा एंड द ग्रेट सोल पंडित तारानाथ जी late Dr. M. Ishwar Reddy ji, late Dr. G. Srinivas Acharya sir, and all the staff members, participants, and my dear friend Dr. Parameshwarappa S. Badgi. With the permission of our beloved principal Dr. Syed Attar Fatima madam, today we are having second webinar upon the title Rajyakshma. From yesterday, we are celebrating World Tuberculosis Week. In this issue, the Department of Postgraduate Studies in Kaya Chikitsa, Taranath Government Ayurveda College, Bellary, is conducting a series of guest lectures in this COVID-19 pandemic. Once again, in South India, COVID is increasing. So the best way of communication is the webinars. I am very happy to welcome Dr. Badgi, my friend from the time of undergraduation, a wonderful personality, very honest man, and it is our proud that he is recently appointed as professor of Rog Nidana and Vikriti Vijnana. I congratulate you sir. It is an occasion to welcome you for this session here. Every speaker will be sharing the knowledge pertaining to Rajyakshma and its interpretation with tuberculosis, so that the postgraduate scholars and the research workers, students, practitioners are benefiting. In the morning, Dr. Mohammad Rafi Hullur, who is a teacher for both of us, has given the first lecture on the analytical approach of Rajayakshmi. So now it is high time that one of the experts in Roganidana as well as Kaya Chikitsa, Dr. Parameshwarappa, whom we have requested him to give a lecture on this regard, he was immediately accepted our invitation. It shows love and affection towards Karnataka. I thank you, sir, for accepting the invitation, and I welcome, without taking much of the time, to start your address. Welcome you, sir, again.
Thank you, sir, for your kind word.
Start, sir.
Okay, sir. Actually, it is very unfortunate that we lost two stalwarts, Professor Iswar Reddy sir and Professor Srinivacharya sir. So both are the stalwarts in their own capacity. Both contributed significantly for the development of especially the Kaya Chikitsa and Panchakarma. Iswar Reddy sir was the very much scholarly contributed towards the development of the Panchakarma, and Srinivacharya sir was contributing both for Panchakarma as well as for the Kaya Chikitsa. So it is very sad and unfortunate that we lost these two scholars, and in their memory, so the TGAMC has conducted the lecture for their to dedicate to their contributions made to the progress of Ayurveda, especially towards Panchakarma and Kaya Chikitsa. I am very much thankful to the principal madam for inviting me to deliver a lecture on this. I am also thankful to one of my best friends during my UG studies, Professor Madhav Digavi sir. And we, during your UG studies also, we used to interact with him. And he used to guide us always and motivating us to do very good in the studies. So I am thankful to you, sir, for inviting me and to deliver a lecture on the topic on the Rajayakshma. So there are options which are available in the current scenario, but there are difference of opinion as you are making an arrangement on the Rajayakshma itself. So I have a different of opinion whether this Rajayakshma can be compared with that of the tuberculosis, because you are making it tuberculosis weak. But I have some difference of opinion in that. So anyhow, I will go through it, and during my 1 hour presentations, so I will put forward my views, and so that it will be open for discussion later. So can you start the slide presentation? So today I am going to discuss about the critical understanding of the Rajayakshma from the current perspectives. So there are different terminologies used in the classical texts of Ayurveda. Some people are using it as Kshaya Roga, some people are calling it as an Ekshma Roga, some people are calling it as a Rajayakshma, some people are calling it as a Shosha Roga. So there will be a difference of opinion, and there will be different chapters which are dedicated. And so if you go to the Nidana Sthana, it has been described as Shosha Nidana, but if you go to the Chikitsa, the Charaka is mentioned as the Rajayakshma Chikitsa. So there will be a difference of opinion when it comes to the nomenclature of the disease Rajayakshma, but when it comes to the descriptions and discussions regarding the disease, there won't be any much discussions on that. Next slide. Slide. Who is going to making, who is changing? Okay, fine. So there will be when it comes to the understanding of the disease, so regarding this particular disease, it has been already told in the many years before, aneka roganugato bahu roga puragamaha rajayakshma kraya shosho roga raditi chasmrita. So it has been clearly mentioned in the most classical texts of Ayurveda it has been mentioned that aneko roga anugato, it manifests with many diseases. Bahu roga parogamaha, it is the disease which is susceptible to develop the innumerable number of diseases. It is known as Rajakshma, it is also known as Kshaya, it is also known as Shosha, it is also known as Rogara. So these are the four synonyms mentioned in context to this particular disease, Rajakshma. In the Susruta Samhita, again, there will be same terminologies, Aneka Roga Anugato, Bahuroga Paragamaha. Again, but the second line is very important. Durvidneyoha, it's very, very difficult to understand. And Durnivarha, it's very, very difficult for the management. Shosho Vadir Mahabalha, it is known as Shosha, and it is the Mahabala, and it is very, very powerful disease, and it is a fatal disease. It is going to cause a lot of complications. Next. Next slide. Okay. There are different terminologies. Again, Susruta says why it has been used as a shosha. Sam shoshanadrasadinam shosha itte vidyate. It means that it is darbin because of the predominance of the dosha, that is vata. The tendency of vata is to dry up the shoshana karma of the rasadi dhatu. So because of the excessive exacerbation of the vata dosha, it dries up the vital body tissues, that is rasadi dhatus, that is resulting into the development of emaciation or the wasting disease or some that kind of thing. That's why it is called as shosha. Kriyakshaya karatvach kshayituchyate punaha. Kriyakshaya karatvach, what are the physiological functions attributed to the bodies, dhatus as well as to the doshas, they have become compromised. As well as some people are also mentioned that kriya kshaya, when there are less number of there will be durvidya durnivaro, what Susruta is told. So when it comes to the treatment point of view, it becomes very, very difficult to understand. It's very, very difficult for the management. So the remedies which are available for this is very, very less in number. In that context also, some people will describe this kriyakshayatvaratvat. Rajya rajnas chandramaso yasmad bhutesh kilameha. So you know that there was a mythological story behind this particular disease. So the Raja Chandra was got affected with this disease. Because of that, it is known as the Rajakshma. That's why it is called as the Rajakshma in the earth. So these are the different synonyms which have been told in context to the understanding of this particular disease. So the word Shosha, Kshaya and Rajakshma are synonymous. Only thing is, only the because of the different approaches, the different theories which have been attributed, including that of the mythological story, including that of the pathophysiology, including that of the treatment point of view. So there will be one Rajakshma from the point of view of the mythological story, and Kriya Karatvas from the point of view of treatment point of therapeutic point of view, and Samshoshana Drasadhanam from the point of the pathophysiological point of view. Next slide. So there are four important etiological factors which are responsible for the development of this particular disease. So one is the suppression of the manifested natural urges, and the Vegadharana, what we call, or Sandharana. Number two is the reduction of the quantity of the tissue elements, and the either pratilomakshaya or anulomakshaya. Then the third one is the sahasa or sahasa janya, that is the performance of excess activities behind one's own strength. Next one is the vishamashana. Next slide. So that is sahasa is an etiological fact. Sahasa is an etiological factor. So which has been told, because most of the time we never study this particular point of view in a very clear cut manner. So this is very beautiful version given in Charaka Samhita Nidanasthana. So this sahasam soshayas animiti aduktam. So I will not go into this sloka in detail, but how this particular the sahasa janas rajakshma manifest. So performing an exercise behind one's own capacity resulting into that. For example, it balavat balavatasa vigrudite, you are fighting with the powerful person, so are you were lifting the very heavy these things, and you are making the indulging in such activities, or indulging in excessive swimming, you're indulging in excessive walking, you are excessive walking and excessive these things, you know, jumping and all those things. So any physical activities you are performing in excess quantity, and you are exposing your body and garshana to the body, excessive trauma to the body in any these things. So that will resulting into the development of excessive physical activities you are performing without considering one's own strength. So that will resulting into the reduction of the reduction of the vital tissues there in that particular, especially in the whole body muscles or the other body tissues will be get sthilata, and then that will leads to the development of the that particular kshata or injury will leads to the aggravation of the vata. So this particular aggravated vata will make an urahasthita sleshma, it will mix up with the urahasthita sleshma and pitta, and it will move either in the upward direction or the downward direction or in the tirrak directions, you know. So that will leads to the development of the disease. So the purpose is, say, vata ruddhikara, vata, excessive physical activities, we call it as one of the etiological factors, in that maybe you are doing any physical activities, you are doing lifting heavy weight or indulging into the activities which you are performing without considering your own strength, and that will result into the aggravation of the vata in the urha pradesha, and then this particular aggravated vata mix with that of the sleshma and pitta, and then it will move either in upward, downward, or in the tirrak gati, and leads to the development of the shosha roga. Next slide. Okay, so this particular thing I always consider it as an very beautiful descriptions which are given to a certain extent extra pulmonary tuberculosis, including the pulmonary tuberculosis as well as the extra pulmonary tuberculosis can be considered in this particular point of view. I will give justification to that, why I have mentioned this here, pulmonary tuberculosis as well as extra pulmonary tuberculosis, because the most commonly involved site as mentioned in modern medicine are lymph nodes, pleura, genitourinary tract, bones, joints, meninges, peritoneum and pericardium. However, virtually all organ system may be affected. So not only those areas, but those are the above mentioned areas are more commonly affected. But other than that, there may be in other areas may also be get affected. But as a result of hematogenous dissemination in HIV infected individuals, extra pulmonary tuberculosis is seen more commonly today than in the past. Next one. I will, in continuation of that, the Sahasa Janya Raja Yakshma. So in that continuation, that aggravated vata in combination with vata and pitta in Urha Pradesha, moving in upward, downward or zigzag direction, will reaches the Sandhi Pradesha. Yaha Sarira Sandhina Vishati Tenasya Jrumba Angamardo Jarashchoka Jayate. So it means that our acharas are also aware that, so this particular pathogenetic components, this particular causative factors will enter into the joints and causing the disease shosha roga. So that we can compare with that of the skeletal tuberculosis. In bone and joint disease, as you know, that there will be a related to the reactivation of the hematogenous foci are to spread from adjacent paravertebral lymph nodes. So this was a beautiful concept given in Ayurveda also. Without the involvement of the vata, nothing moves inside. So there will be a spread of that particular thing. Maybe we can compare this hematogenous foci to that of the pitta dosha, as well as that will spread from the adjacent paravertebral lymph nodes to that of the pitta, kapha dosha. So that will help to spread from that particular area to the skeletal area. So especially the weight-bearing joints, the spine in 40% of the cases, the hips in 13% of the cases, and knees in 10% of the cases are most commonly affected. This spinal tuberculosis, you might have heard most of the time, Pott's disease or tuberculosis spondylitis often involves two or more adjacent vertebral bodies. And if it has not been managed properly, that will leads to the most of the, especially that leads to the formation of the gibbous. But while in the upper thoracic spine is the most common site of the spinal TB in the children, and the lower thoracic and upper lumbar vertebra are usually affected in the adults. With advanced disease, collapse of the vertebral bodies, for example, if the treatment has been not initiated in the initial phase of it, leads to the kyphosis and there will be formation of the gibbous. So the paravertebral cold abscess may also form in the upper spine. This abscess may track and to penetrate the chest wall, presenting as a soft tissue mass. It's very, very commonly presented here. And in the lower spine, it may reach the inguinal ligaments, are present as a psoas abscess. So that any cold abscess that should be properly evaluated examine the cases as the tuberculosis, skeletal tuberculosis. And TB of the hip joints, usually involving the head of the tumor, causes pain, but TB of the knee produces pain as well as the swelling. Next. In continuation of that, so the first area which was involved is in the entry of the doshas to the joints, that we can compare with that of the just the next one is the this particular doshas will enter amashaya. Yes, amashaya mabhupayati tena roga bhavanti urasya arochakasya. So that we can compare with that of the this particular if it, these doshas will make enters into the amashaya, and it may be compared with that of the gastrointestinal tuberculosis. Gastrointestinal tuberculosis is uncommon, making up 3.5% of the extrapulmonary cases in the United States. But various pathogenetic mechanisms are involved in the development of this particular disease, especially the swallowing of the sputum with direct seeding. Wherever there will be these things, there will be seeding is there in the throat and directly you are inhaling without swallowing that, or hematogenic spread, or largely in the developing areas, ingestion of milk from cows affected by the bovine tuberculosis. That is very, very common. All the winning portion of the gastrointestinal tract may be affected. So any part is not, but the most commonly is terminal ileum and the cecum are the site most commonly involved. So the presentations are, the patient will present with the abdominal pain at times similar to that associated with appendicitis. Sometimes the patient may confuse with that, that presentations will be there because the patients will be having the fever as well as the abdominal pain. And the swelling, obstruction, hematochezia, and palpable mass in the abdomen are common findings at presentations associated with fever, weight loss, anorexia, and night sweat are also common presentation in the gastrointestinal tuberculosis. But tuberculous peritonitis follows either the direct spread of tubercle bacilli from ruptured lymph nodes and intra-abdominal organ, that is genital TB in women, or hematogenous CD. So non-specific abdomen pain, fever, ascites should raise the suspicion of tuberculous peritonitis. Next one. So the third area mentioned in this loci is if this particular aggravated dosas enters into the kanta, kantam avi prapadyate, kantaste nadvamsate, swarasavasidate. So that we can compare with that of the TB of the upper airways, nearly always a complication of advanced cavitary pulmonary tuberculosis. TB of the upper airways may involve the larynx, pharynx, and epiglottis. So symptoms include are the hoarseness, dyspnea, and dyspepsia in addition to the chronic productive cough. So, and again, Ayurveda also mentioned the similar presentations. The findings also depends on the site of involvement, and ulcerations may be seen on the laryngoscopy. But acid fast smear of the sputum is often positive, but biopsy may be necessary in some cases to establish this diagnosis. So very important is carcinoma of the larynx may have a similar features but is always a painless one. Next. The another one is if these particular doshas will make an entry into the yaha prana vahini srotam sanveti tena swasaha pratishayasya jayate. So if it enters into the pranava srotas, so this we can compare with that of the pulmonary tuberculosis. So the pulmonary tuberculosis can be conveniently categorized as primary or the post-primary, that is adult type or secondary. The primary tuberculosis, primary pulmonary tuberculosis occurs soon after the initial infection with the tubercle bacilli. It may be asymptomatic or present with fever and occasionally pleuritic chest pain. In areas of the high tubercle transmission, so this form of disease is often seen, especially in the children's, because most inspired air is distributed to the middle and lower lung zones, and these areas of the lungs are most commonly involved in the primary tuberculosis. The lesions forming after the initial infection, that is known as the confocus, is usually peripheral and accompanied by a transient hilar and paratracheal lymphadenopathy, which may not be visible on standard chest radiograph. Sometimes the patients may develop erythema nodosum in the legs or plantagnular conjunctivitis. In the majority of the cases, the lesions heal spontaneously and only become evident as a small calcified nodules. Pleural reaction overlying subpleural focus is also common, but the confocus with or without overlying the pleural reaction, thickening and regional lymphadenopathy is referred to as a gone complex. And this particular gone complex, if it has become ruptured, it may be responsible for the secondary district. Next one. So in continuation with this, there will be post-primary adult type disease is also known as the reactivation of secondary tuberculosis. Post-primary TB is probably most accurately termed adult type tuberculosis, since it may result from the endogenous reactivation of a distant latent infection or recent infection, that is from the primary infection or the reinfection. It is usually localized to the apical or posterior segments of the upper lobes, because this particular upper lobe is a substantially higher mean oxygen retention compared with that in the lower zones, favors the mycobacterial growth. So the superior segments of the lower lobes are also more frequently involved. The extent of lung parenchymal involvement varies greatly from small infants to a extensive cavitary disease. Next one. So the next point, it has been told that these particular doshas will enter sirasavatishtate siraste nupahannate. So this can be compared with that of the tuberculous meningitis and tuberculoma. The TB of the central nervous system accounts for the 5% of the extra pulmonary cases in the United States. It is also seen that the young children, it is seen most commonly in the young children, but also develops in the adults, especially those who infected with the HIV infections. The tuberculous meningitis result from the hematogenous spread of primary and post-primary pulmonary tuberculosis or from the rupture of the particularly the post-primary pulmonary tuberculosis or from the rupture of the sub-ependymal tubercle into the subarachnoid space. The disease often presents subtly as a headache and slight mental changes after a prodrome of a week of low-grade fever, malaise, anorexia and irritability. So that we call it as an Ayurveda prodrome, that is a pururupa. The clinical presentations are low-grade fever, malaise, anorexia and irritability. These are all some of the presentations mentioned in the Rajakshma Pururupa also. So if not recognized, so the tubercular meningitis may evolve acutely with severe headache, confusion, lethargy and altered sensorium. And the very important is the neck rigidity. So the disease evolves over 1 to 2 weeks, a course longer than that of the bacterial meningitis. Since meningeal involvement is pronounced at the base of the brain, paresis of the cranial nerves, ocular nerve is in particular, is frequently finding, and the involvement of cerebral arteries may produce focal ischemia. So the ultimate evolution towards coma and hydrocephalus and intracranial hypertension is also noticed in these cases. Next. So the next important, the last line of this particular sloka goes, tata kshanana chayo uraso visamagatitvacha vayoho kantasya chadvamsanat kasaha satatamasya sanjayate sa kasa prasangadurasi shate shonitam stivati shonita agamitavna chasya darbal. Sorry. Shonita agamitavna దౌర్బల్యం ఉపజాయితే ఏమైతే సహస ప్రభవ సహసికం ఉపద్రవ స్పృశంతి. వెరీ బ్యూటిఫుల్ కొటేషన్స్. వాట్ ఇట్ సేస్, దిస్ పర్టిక్యులర్ వాయు ఆఫ్టర్ ఎంటరింగ్ ఇన్ టు ది కంట ప్రదేశ అండ్ ఆల్ ఏరియాస్ ఇట్ ఇండ్యూసెస్ ది కంటిన్యూస్ కాసా. బికాస్ ఆఫ్ కంటిన్యూస్ కాసా ఇట్ లీడ్స్ టు ది శోణిత స్టీవన, దట్ ఇస్ హెమప్టైసిస్. And that particular, because of the continuous hemoptysis, there will be durbalita, and that will, these are the some of the complications. So the modern medicine also says the same thing. So 90% of the cases, cough eventually develops, often initially non-productive and limited to the morning, and subsequently accompanied by the production of purulent sputum, sometimes with blood sticking. Very beautiful description. Ayurveda also says initially it was an very, because of vata predominance, there will be non-productive, but later, because of the involvement of the kapha, the patient will be bahalam, maduram, pichilam, visram, durganda. That kind of presentations are also told for this kapha, the product sputum. So the hemoptysis develops in 20-30% of the cases. Massive hemoptysis may ensue as a consequence of erosion of a blood vessel in the wall of the cavity. Because of that, sideways road, chadvamshanat kasaha satatas masya sanjayate. So that blood vessel, that consequence of the erosion of a blood vessel in the wall of a cavity, hemoptysis, however, may also result from a ruptured dilated vessel in the cavity. That's called a resumescence aneurysm, or from the aspergilloma formation in an old cavity. Next one. So another important beautiful quotation is, if the disease has not been properly treated, if the disease has not been properly treated, so that will lead to upashoshanai rete rupadrave drupadata sanai sanai rupashushate. Gradually the person become emaciated, consumptive, it becomes very weaker and weaker, and that's why it is called, as some people will write this Rajakshma as a consumption and disease of the consumption and all those things. Okay, so that is why it is very, very important to note down that okay, so that when it comes to the correlation what the people are making with that of that. So because it senai senai rupashushate, it gradually makes the person emaciated, consumption leads to consumption. So that's it. Even Ayurveda also, even in the modern medicine also says, there will be gradual accumulation, there will be a gradual declining of the strength of a person, because this tubercle vessel will not make the person weaker in a very short period of time. It takes a longer duration of time to develop that particular condition. Next one. So the sandharana etiological factors is another etiological factors, which the first one we discussed was the same, that is the sahasa etiological factor. Number two is the sandharana etiological factor. Next. That's in Vegavaroda. Sandharana, again, it has been told, who are more prone to make an, there are three important things, you know, Vata, Mutra, Purusha, Vegan. So there will be suppression of Vata, Vega, Mutra, Vega, Purusha, Vega. Why? The people who are working closely with the Raja, or with the teachers, or with the were doing some work where there will be whole females are surrounded by that particular person. Like that, you know, you are doing such kind of work where you don't get a time to go to pass these kinds of things. So as a result of that, you are controlling or you are suppressing the natural urges of Vata, Mutra and Purusha. So that will lead to the aggravation of the Vata in turn, which combines with the Pitta and Sleshma, and it will again goes to the Urdhva, Adha and the Tirayak directions and leads to the development of the disease Shosha Roga. Next. See, this again very important slide. Tatashchava visheshena purovacharirāvāyava vishesha praviṣṣe. So, in Sahasa Rajakshma, in Sahasa Janya Rajakshma, that what is one called purovacharirāvāyava vishesha. Earlier I told, so what are the areas from Sandhi to that of the Sra. So that to the Pranavasa. So in that area, this particular aggravated Vatas goes there and manifests the different kinds of clinical presentations the same way, which can be discussed with little bit changes in the slight clinical presentations. So that way, the earlier I will not take much into that, because the same presentations will be there, like amsam udgate kanta vadvamsate sarasya pahanti kasa swasam. So these are the clinical presentations, and lastly again in the same way, sane rupadrita sane sane rupashvishate, same also the person become the consumption or become emaciated. Tasmat purusho, that's what, next one. So kshaya as etiological factor, the third one is the kshaya as etiological factors. In that again we can classify into anuloma kshaya and pratiloma kshaya. Next. See, kshaya, again there will be one is shosha. This particular kshaya is maybe because of the shoka, chinta, these are all the ati matra, indulging into those kinds of things, indulging in irsat, kanta, bhaya, krodha, adi, samavishyate. So if the person who is indulging into these kinds of things and performing and eating the food or indulging into excess in quantity, so that will, in that particular, along with that, the person who is indulging in the excessive shoka, chinta, as well as irsha, bhaya, krodha, adi, associated with intake of the rukshanna panasevi, the indulging into the rukshahara vihara, so that is vata pravakitu, katutitta kashaya pradhanahara vihara, durbala prakurtir anaharo alpahari. The person is always durbala prakurti in this sense here. There will be an vata prakriti persons who are vata prakriti person, an aharo, alpaharo, not at all taking the food, or alpaharo bhavati, tada hrudaya sthaya rasa samayam upayati. That will lead to the development of the depletion of the rasa dhatu, and that is known as the kshaya chosham prapnoti apratikara. It's an important line, it has been told here. So this will lead to the tas upakshaya. There will be dhatu kshaya, there will be a rasadi dhatu kshaya leads to kshaya, that prakshaya leads to shosha roga, shosham prapnoti apratikarat chanubaddhite. Very important, like if it has not been treated, if it has not been treated properly, ekshmana yato upadeshmari, that leads to the development of the ekshma. In this particular context, so there will be three different stages have been told, kshaya, shosha and rajekshma. That kind of stage has been told in context to the anuloma kshaya. Next. In the other way is the pratiloma kshaya, where the excessive indulgence into the atiharsha, the prasakta bhavaha, strishma, excessive indulgence into the sexual intercourse, or indulging into sexual intercourse with the multiple partners, that will lead to the ati matra prasanga, excessive indulgence into the sexual activities. So that was the reason which when you're explaining this mythological story of the Rajakshma, so the the Daksha Prajapati's 28 daughters are married to Chandrama, Then that of then Rohini was the very beautiful among 28, and Chandrama was more attracted towards that particular Rohini and was giving more pleasure to her and indulging more sexual activities only with Rohini and neglecting the other remaining 27 daughters. As a result of that, Daksha become infuriated and become anger, and then he gave an sharper to that Chandrama, and then as a result of that, his dhatus become dried up and will develop the disease Shosha Roga. That's why it is known as because the king Chandrama was affected with this disease, that's why it is called as the Chandrama. So there also it has been told that the excessive indulgence of the sexual activities, that will lead to the again development of this. Again, it has been told that Tasya Chati Pranita Sankalpasya Maituna Madhyamanasana Sukram. If there is due to excessive sexual intercourse, so initially there will be formation of the Sukra and the Sukra comes out. But if the Sukra is not, because there will be some certain days is required, certain time is required to form the Sukra again. So you are not giving time and again indulging into the sexual activities. That's why again it has been told Sukram Pravartate Ati Matra Krina Resat Krina Ritaswa Tata Asya. Because of that, na sukram pravartate, because of that, there won't be any formation of the sukra, sukra won't come. But ati matra pakshina rasatvat, tata asya vayur vich manav sirirasya, jamani ranu pravishya shonita vahini stabdha. So that will lead to the rupture of the vessels, shonita vahini, rupture of the blood vessels in that. As a result of that, blood will come out of it, and then So, from the marga of the sukra marga, so the blood starting, so vatanu sruta lingam, so it comes out with the blood instead of the sukra. So, as a result of the excessive indulgence of that, that's as a result of that, there will be deflation of the sukra, the dhatus, then again, there will be rakta started coming out. So there will be the inversely there will be depletion of the other dhatus, and as a result of that, so there will be development of the shosha inside the body. Next. Again, the same thing which has been told here also, the kriya atasya sukra kshaya sonita pravartanacha sandayaha, same thing, the other areas which have been discussed earlier, that it goes to the sandeha, sandeha sitila bhavati, raksham apajayate, bhuyaha sriram dharbalyam avishanti, vahyu prakupam apadyanti, sa pravika vashikam. So these are all the areas where there will be in parishoshayati, mamsa shonite. It makes the dryness of the body and it brings the, it dries up the mamsa as well as shonita, and then in combined with the sleshma and pitta, it manifests the Parsva avamrudgam atyasau, tarubhin parsva shula, then kanta mudvamshati, sirahasleshmanam upatklesha pratipurayan sleshmana, sandhisya prapidayan. So these are all, that indicates the, there have been that particular aggravated doshas will enter into the different body organs, starting with that of the sandhi, to that of the kanta, to that of the sira, then as a result of it will go to the pranava srutas and manifest the symptoms like, you know, kasa swasa kshate shonita stivati shonita agamanasya. So the last line again, the same is in all the sloka is upashoshane retai rupadrava rupai drutaha sanai sanai rupashushate. Very important. So this particular word sanai sanai rupashushate is given to the sahasa sandharana as well as to the Chayajanya Rajaksha. Next. So Vishamashana, you know that, you know, Vishamashana is irregularity in the intake of the food, irregularity in the timing of the food, excess intake of the food, or maybe less intake of the food, or intake of improperly processed food, if the food is not properly processed. Next. So it has been clearly mentioned, Charaka, in the next loka. Next. See, Vishamashanam Shoshash Ayatanamiti Aduktam, again it has been told, Parushaha Pana Ashana Baksha Lehadinam. Whatever eating, pana, drinking, or you are eating, whatever the chewable and all those things, प्रकृतिकरण संयोग राशि देश काल उपयोग संस्थोपशय विषमान सेवते सो वट एवर द आहार विधि विशेष आयतना सर मेंशनड इन कॉन्टेक्स्ट प्रकृति करण राशि संयोग इवन विषमान सेवते इफ आर नॉट फॉलोइंग द डाइटेटिक रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशंस इन कॉन्टेक्स्ट टू दैट दैट विल लीड्स टू द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर थिंग सो तीबो वात पित्त श्लेष्मान वैषम्य मान उपपद्यते वैषम्य मान उपपद्यते सो दैट विल लीड्स टू विषम अगेन दिस पर्टिकुलर थिंग leads to the vata pitta shleshma will become become vishamyata at this particular vishama sharira manusrutya yada srotasam and it makes an obstruction in the channels of the srotas and this particular obstructed sloka the srotas will make an jantur ahara jata maharati tadatasya mut पुरीशमेवोपजायते भूइष्टं नान्यत् तथा शरीरधातु इट हैज बीन क्लियरली मेंशन्ड दैट बिकॉज़ ऑफ द रेगुलरिटी इन इट इट आर नॉट फॉलोइंग द रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशंस ऑफ दिस प्रकृतिकरण आदितेस थिंग सो दैट विल मेक द ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन इन द चैनल्स ऑफ सर्कुलेशन एज वेल एज इट विल लीड्स टू द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ द मूत्र पुरीशमेवोपजायते So whatever the food which you are going to take it out, it will be get converted into either that is aharamala, that is the mutra and purusha. Pajayate bhuishtam sarir dhatuhu. Purushopadrushta dhe dhe tasma chvayush visheshena, tasma chushyate vayutna purusha manuraksham asam kurushpalana. So that is why the there will be, because of the less formation of the adhyarasa dhatu, so there will be an ksosha. Will take place inside the body. Next one. Next slide. Okay, so then again it has been told that prutak prutak the parima pashayanti then vataha sula angamardakantu seem the presentations of the presentations will be changed because of vata there will be sula angamardakanta dvamsamana पार्श्व समृजन अवसमर्द स्वर भेद प्रतिशाय चोपजायते बिकॉज ऑफ पित्त दुर्बियन ज्वर अतिसार अंतर्दाह बिकॉज ऑफ श्लेष्म प्रतिशाय सरसो गुरुत्व अरोचकम कासम च कास प्रसंगा दुरसी क्षते श्रोणितम निष्ठीवते सो दीज आर ऑल द सेम क्लिनिकल प्रेजेंटेशन सो द लास्ट लाइन अगेन देन इट विल सोल्ड विषमाशनोपचिता स्त्रियो दोषा राजयक्ष्माणाम विवर्तन्ति स तैरुपशोषणैर् उपद्रवैर् द्रुपदता शनैः शनैः सुष्यते सो दिस इज द कॉमन श्लोका गिवन फॉर इवन फॉर विषमासन जनित राजयक्ष्माल सो द ग्रेजुअली देयर विल बी एन ड्राइनिंग ड्राइनेस ऑफ द इमेसिएशन ऑफ द कंजम्पशन ऑफ द बॉडी नेक्स्ट So this we can compare how we can compare the etiological factors mentioned in Ayurveda with that of the present and tuberculosis. So in my opinion, so the disease Rajyakshma etiological factors will the whatever the four etiological factors are mentioned are indicative towards the immunological defense mechanism. In my opinion, there will be an immunodeficiency state resulting a compromised immune status because of this vata. Vata is vata aggravation. All vata aggravating etiological factors are responsible for the declining of the immune system inside the body. So as a result of that, so the modern medicine also says the same thing. Unlike the risk of acquiring the infection with Mycobacterium tuberculosis, the risk of developing disease after being infected depends largely on endogenous factor such as individual's innate immunological and non-immunological defenses and the level of function of the cell-mediated immunity. So this is the basic thing which decides the entry of infection till the manifestation of the disease. There will be entry of the infection, but the most of the people will not develop the disease because this will again depends on the innate immunologic and non-immunological defenses and the level of function of the cell mediated ability. So that is why, in my opinion, the Raja eczema is not only the tuberculosis, but this may be compared with that of immunocompromised persons. So the critical illness, the clinical illness directly following the infection is classified as primary tuberculosis and is common among children in the first few years of life because the immune system was not properly developed, and among immunocompromised persons. So the whatever the four etiological factors are mentioned, so that will hint towards the compromised immune system of an individual. Okay, next. So the variety of diseases and conditions favor the development of the active tuberculosis. So in the absolute terms, the most potent risk factor for tuberculosis affected infected individuals is clearly HIV co-infection. So I will say that there have been that pratiloma kshaya, because of the excessive sexual indulgence, leads to the development of HIV infections, what the present medical science says. So this was known to our acharyas also. So that is why it has been clearly told that in absolute term, the most potent risk factor for TB among infected individuals is clearly HIV co-infection, which suppresses the cellular immunity. The risk that latent mycobacterium tuberculosis infection will proceed to active disease is directly related to the patient's degree of immunosuppression. Further, tuberculin skin test in case of HIV infected patients, persons, the risk is varied from 2.6 to 13.3 among the persons, 100 persons per year, per 100 person years, and increased as the CD4 T plant is decreased. Next. So risk factors for active tuberculosis among persons who have been infected with tuberculosis bacilli is recent infection, less than 1 year, one who is infected with that but not properly treated, fibrotic lesions and comorbidity, suffering from HIV infections, silicosis, chronic renal failure, hemodialysis, diabetes mellitus, IV drug use, immunosuppressive treatment, gastrectomy, jejuno-ileal bypass, post-transplantation period, renal and cardiac, tobacco smoking, and malnutrition and severe underweight. So these are all the nidanas which have been told even in Ayurveda also to a certain extent. Says that there is the person who is compromised with the immune functions. Next. Then the people are arguing that, okay, where there is a direct reference, to say that yes, Raja eczema is going to manifest because of the causative factors as sankramika roga. Yes, of course, it has been told in Ayurveda also, prasangat, jata samsparshat, nishwasat, sahabhojanat, sahasayasanat, chapi, vastra malyanu lepanat, kustam, jarasth, sosasth, netravisandha evacha, aupasargika rogasth, sankramanti, naranara. So this is a very clear-cut evident mentioned in Susruta Samhita, clearly indicates this particular disease is a communicable disease. Next. So this way we can compare with that. Yes, Ayurvedic acharyas are also aware that from exposure to the infections, that from exposure to the infection, yes, definitely. And Ayurveda also says the same thing, commonly transmitted from person with infected pulmonary tubercle to the others by a droplet nuclei, which are aerosolized by coughing, sneezing and speaking. And the tiny droplet dry rapidly, but the smallest may remain suspended in the air for several hours and may reach the terminal air passages when inhaled. So there may be as many as 3,000 infectious nuclei per cup. So that is very, very important. And this other routes of transmission of the tubercle bacilli through skin or the placenta are very, very uncommon. But until and unless skin becomes this thing, but otherwise, and of no epidemiological significance. But that's not the entry, but the because bacteria will not survive in that particular route. But very rare incidences have been recorded. The probability of contact with a person who has an infectious form of tuberculosis, the intimacy and duration of that contact, the degree of the infectiousness of the case, the shared environment in which the contact takes place are all important determinants of the likelihood of transmission. The same has been told, prasangat, ghatasmasmasat, nisvasat, sabhojana. crowding in poorly ventilated rooms is one of the most common important factor in the transmission of tuberculosis bacilli because it increases the intensity of the contact with the case. Next. So the Rudbin, when it comes to the samprapti of the disease, kapha pradhanayar doshesu ruddhesu rasavartmasu, that has been told because of the aggravated kapha vata dosha, there will be the functions of the digestive agni becomes compromised. As a result of there will be an adhya rasadhatu which has been found, but there will be an rasadhatu kata malarupi kapha is formed in excess, and that's the reason that has been told in this particular context, which has been told in context to the anulomakshaya. Next, in atilom pratilomakshaya, it has been clearly mentioned that it is again because of the ativyavayino api kshine ritasa anantaram kshiyate dhatava sushyante mana, because of the excess of sexual intercourse, so there will be an kshinata of the sukra dhatu, and that will make a dryness of the remaining dhatus. Next, the susrut in the Chanaka Samhita and Chikitsa Sthana, it has been told, you know that everybody knows that atasve noshmana pakam sariram yanti dhatava, that's what I told, but in susruta has been in Sleshmana Ruddha Margis, that has been kapha pradhana doshestu, but here it has been cleared. Why the kapha has become more pradhanata has been clearly mentioned here. Yatasve noshmana pakam sarira mayanti dhatavaha srotasam yatasve ne dhatu pushyanti dhatva. It has been clear concept that, so there will be dhatu, there will be sarira ushma il vede, so that will make helpful for the paka inside the body. As a result of that, there will be all body dhatus will get the nourishment, proper nourishment, and as a result of that body will grow normal. But what happens in case of the Raja Express? Srotasam sannirodasche rakta adinam chamkshayat. There will be an obstruction in the srotas. Rakta adidhatu kshaya is in vide. Dhatushmanam cha apajayat. Dhatushmana cha apajayat Raja Express pravartate. There will be an decreased functions of the dhatu ka ushma, there will be an decreased functions of the digestive functions or the metabolic functions of the body. That's why there will be an excessive breakdown of the proteins is resulting component of the gradual emaciation of consumption of the body. And these are the three important components. Srutasam sannirodhasch, obstruction of the srutas, raktadi dhatukshaya, then dhatu ushmana apachaya, there will be an decreased metabolic activities inside the body. Tasmin kale pachayat pachat agni adannam kosta samsritam. So as a result of that, the kosta agni is not able to digest the food whatever the person is going to cook. Mali bhavat mali bhavati tat prayah kalpate kinchid ojase. As a result of that, there will be an excessive formation of the sari dhatum sariramala, that is mali bhavati, there will be an excessive formation with the mutra and purusha, tat prayaha kalpate kinchid ojase, as a result of there will be little formation of the ujas. Tasmat purisam samraksha, that's the reason it has been told in Charaka Samhita, because mala purusha is acting as an bala, so don't allow the whole purusha to come out of the body, that's why it has to be preserved. Sarva dhatu kshayartasya balam tasya, because bala, mala is acting as a bala to a certain extent, hence it has been told rasaha srotasu ruddesu so sthanasya vidayate. So rasadi dhatus will get obstructed, there will be this thing that there will be a burning sensation. So urdvam, that particular rasadhatu gata ushma is compromised, as a result of that there will be an excessive formation of the rasadhatukata malarupi kapha, and which comes out in the form urdhva kasa vegena bahu rupaha pravartate. So it comes out from the upper pathways in the form of kapha in a different ways. Maybe that's the reason it has been told in Ayurveda, bahalam, pichlam, maduram, you know, durgandam, that kind of thing presentations was told in context to the kapha with the sputum. Jayante vadayasya sadikadasya vapanaha, that is either it manifests the ekadasha, that is sad ekadasya vapanaha, there will be ekadasya rajyakshma, 11 symptoms or sadrupa symptoms, are there will be that kind of presentation that has been, I will come into detail of that. So Kasam Satapa Varasaravate, again it has been told that Sarvai Rabis Tribirva Api Lingam Balakshaye. So all the appearance of all the 3, 6 or 11 symptoms of it, Yukto Varjiya Chikitsa Sarva Api Nanti. If there will be a presence of all these symptoms are there, that should be rejected for the treatment. Next one. So this Pururupa Lakshanas also prior to the manifestation of the disease, very beautiful presentations are told. So because it has been told in Ayurveda also, the person will not become emaciated or become consumption. Development of consumption will take gradually. So it has been told that initially the patient will present with that of the Pratishaya, Shavatur, Abhikshanam, Shleshma Prasekaha. So the Ananabhilasha, there is lack of desire to take, there will be fetal edema, and there will be excessive akshno, suvita, basata, chati matram. There will be that kind of presentations which indicates towards that. So these clinical presentations certain clinical presentations are indicated towards the respiratory tract system. Some of the clinical presentations are like mukamadurya, ananabhilasa, annakale chayasa. There will be even while taking the food, there will be that pratishaya, shavatur abhikshanam, then slesham prasayika, mukamadhuram, ananabhilasa, annakale ayasa, dosha darshanam, adosha doshave vabhavetu. There won't be any doshas, but there will be this thing, dosh, patra, udaka, anna, supa, damsham, parivetrishesheshu. There won't be any doshas are there in the utensils or in the food or any other items, but finding fault in that. So the remaining, you know that bhakta vastala, sarulla, satatola, these things, antara mukasham, padayoshcha, shopaha, there will be an facial edema and there will be an edema in the lower limbs and pannor, akshno, matartam, there will be an excessive pain or excessive malaise in the whole body. And excessive desire towards the three, and the excessive dreams which we can see it out, which have been where become, there will be a lack of a reservoir, there will be the reservoirs are full of lack of water or dryness, and there will be the place where it has become burnt or this kinds of things. So this kinds of things which indicates the there will be an abnormality in the nourishment of the dhatus. So that's the reason this concept clinical presentations are indicated. As well as this also indicates svetavabhasato chati matram akshnoho svetavabhasato, classical presentations of anemia, mukasya padayosya shopa. Again, these are all the classical presentations of the panduroga which has been mentioned here in the Pururupa avastha of this particular disease. Next. So most of the people are, because of Madhavakara, everybody was talking about the three Rupa Rajakshma, that is Amsa Parsabhita Santapa, but in my opinion, those are not the Pururupa of it. So the Pururupa is the Tribirva Peditam, Jwara, Kasa and Srugamahi. So that is the fever, cough and hemoptysis are the three Rupa Rajakshma. Next. Do you know that Bhakta Dvesha, there is a lack of desire towards take the food, fever, swasa, kasa, sonita, darshana, swarabhedasya, these are the Sadrupa Rajakshma. Next. Same with the charak also, kasa, jara, parsa, shula. Sorry. Varchogada ruchihi. Next. Only the uses of the word varchogada is that is aray. Swarabedo anila chulam samlocha parsway swamsa parsvayoho jwara daha atisarascha pitta draktasya chagamaha sirasa paripurnatvat bhakta chanda evacha kasa kantasya chadvamso vidneha kapakopataha. These are all the some of the 11 projects. Next. Again, sirasa puripurnatvam kasaha swasaha swarabhedaslesh. This indicates that the involvement of the ekadasa rajakshma indicates that there will be an involvement of the multi-system. There is an involvement of the multi-system. Next. Again, there will be much, there is no much difference, but for the reference sake, I mentioned the Pratisaya, Prasekam, Kasam, Chardim, Arochakam, Jaram, Amsavita, Pasti, Dujaral. Okay, go ahead. Next slide. Next. So this we can compare with that of the modern medicine also. The same, it has been told, in the early course of the disease, symptoms and signs are often non-specific and insidious, consisting mainly of diurnal fever. It's a very classical presentation with night sweats due to deprivations, weight loss, anorexia and general malaise and weakness. 90% of the cases, cough eventually develops, often initially with a non-productive because of vata predominance occurred in tired vida, but limited to the morning hours. But later, consequently accompanied by the production of purulent sputum, sometimes with blood sticking. It has been told even in Ayurveda also, Bahalam, Visram, Nigdam, like that presentations, you know, productive sputum has been told. Hemoptysis also develops in 20 to 30% of the cases, and massive hemoptysis may ensue as a consequence of the erosion of the blood vessels in the wall of the cavity. Hemoptysis, however, may also result from rupture of a dilated vessel in a cavity, that is Rasmussen's aneurysm, or from aspergillum formation in an old. Next. Pleuritic chest pain sometimes develops in patients with subpleural parenchyma lesions or pleural disease. Extensive disease may produce dyspnea and in rare instances adult respiratory distress syndrome. Physical findings are of limited use in pulmonary tuberculosis. Many patients have no abnormalities detectable by chest examination, whereas others have detectable rales in the involved areas during inspiration, especially after coughing. Occasionally ranchi due to partial bronchial obstruction. Classical amperic breathe sounds in areas with large cavities may also be heard in few cases. Next. Systemic features are the fever, usually in 80% of the cases, and wasting. And this has been classical feature. Absence of fever, however, does not exclude the tuberculosis, but in some cases, pallor and finger clubbing may develop. The most common hematological findings are mild anemia, leukocytosis and thrombocytosis with a slightly elevated erythrocyte sedimentation rate and the C-reactive protein level. None of these findings is consistent or sufficiently accurate for the diagnostic purposes. Hyponatremia due to the syndrome of inappropriate secretion of antidiuretic hormone has also been reported. So, but the classical presentations, next. The diagnosis can be done based on the degree of suspicion, and it is not difficult to with the high risk patient, especially a homeless alcoholic who presents with typical symptoms and classic chest radiography. Definitely that will hint towards the diagnosis of the tuberculosis. But in the elderly nursing home resident or a teenager with a focal infiltrate may be missed for the diagnosis with the less clinical presentations. But it is entertained when the chest radiograph of a patient is being evaluated for the respiratory symptoms is abnormal. So the patient has no complicating medical condition that cause immunosuppression. The chest radiograph may show typical upper lobe infiltration with cavitation. But the longer the delay between the onset of symptoms and the diagnosis, are more likely is the finding of cavitary disease. In contrast, immunosuppressed patients, including with the HIV infection, may have a typical findings on chest radiography, especially the lower zone infiltrates without cavity formation. Next. You know that acid fast bacilli macroscopy is one of the very important thing which can be collected from the expectorated sputum or from a tissue, especially from lymph node biopsy. But it is an inexpensive but relatively with low sensitivity, that is 40 to 60% in culture confirmed cases of the pulmonary tuberculosis. The traditional method is the light macroscopy specimens, which you know that I will not go into that. Then about this particular the collection of the very important is patients suspected pulmonary. It has been recommended that 2 or 3 sputum specimens preferably collected early in the morning, should be submitted to the laboratory for Aedes smear or mycobacterial culture. But recent also studies have suggested that two specimens collected in the same visit may be as effective as three if the tissue is obtained. It is a criteria that the portion of the specimen intended for culture but not for formaldehyde. So the AB microscopy and urine and gastric Leber's fluid is limited by the presence of commensal mycobacteria that can also give false positive results. Next. Mycobacteria culture, yes, it's one of the gold standard, very important test. It has to be done by the isolation and identification of the mycobacterium tuberculosis from a clinical specimen or from the identification of the specific sequence of the DNA nucleic acid amplification test. So you have to grow in a culture using the different culture medias, that will be a good standard diagnostic test. Next. Another test is the nucleic acid amplification test. Several test systems based on amplification of the mycobacterial nucleic acid are available, but these systems permit the diagnosis of tuberculosis in as little as several hours with high specificity and sensitivity approaching that of the culture. These tests are most useful for rapid confirmation of TB in persons with AB positive specimens, but also have the utility for the diagnosis of AB negative pulmonary and extrapulmonary tuberculosis. The settings where the tests are available, nucleic acid amplification testing should be performed on at least one respiratory specimen from patients with being evaluated for suspected pulmonary. So, and compared to that microbacterial culture, nucleic acid amplification is more confirmatory. Next. The drug susceptibility testing is again initial isolate of mycobacterium tuberculosis should be tested for susceptibility to the four drug regimen, this isoniazid and rifampicin, especially to detect the multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. Okay, next slide. Radiographic procedures are very, very important for the diagnosis of this. As noted above, the initial suspicion of the pulmonary tuberculosis is often based on abnormal chest radiographic finding in a patient with respiratory symptoms. Especially the classic picture is that of upper lobe disease with infiltrates and cavities. Virtually any radiographic pattern from a normal film or a solitary pulmonary nodule to diffuse alveolar infiltrates in a patient with adult respiratory distress syndrome may be seen. In the era of AIDS, no radiographic pattern can be considered pathognomonic. Very important is the CT scan may also be useful in interpreting questionable findings on a plain chest radiography, but may be helpful in diagnosing some forms of extrapulmonary tuberculosis, that's the part spine disease that can be well identified. And MRI is useful in diagnosing intracranial tuberculosis. Next. So additional diagnostic procedures are very, very important where this diagnostic test may be used when pulmonary tuberculosis is suspected, because when there is a sputum is not coming out, in that particular conditions you should the sputum induction by ultrasonic nebulization of hypertonic saline may be useful for patients who cannot produce a sputum specimen spontaneously. So that can be used to take out the sputum sample, and patients with radiographic abnormalities that are consistent with the other diagnosis, that is endobronchial transbronchial biopsy of the lesions can also be taken. Bronchoalveolar lavage of a lung segment containing an abnormality may also be performed. So in very selective patients. Another important thing is invasive diagnostic procedures indicated for patients with suspected extrapulmonary tuberculosis. And there will be an CSF analysis in case of tubercular meningitis, and the pleural fluid and the biopsy sample from the pleural disease biopsy, and the culture of the bone marrow and the liver tissue have a high frequency of positive blood cultures. And the other is the in case of the cultures are negative, but clinical diagnosis of TB is supported by the consistent interferon level, so that can also be useful for the diagnosis of the disease. Next. Next. Okay. Serological other diagnostic test for detecting tuberculosis is the number of serological tests based on detection of the antibodies to a variety of mycobacterial antigens are available in the market, but careful independent assessment of these tests suggests that they are not useful as diagnostic aids, especially in persons with low probability of tuberculosis. Various methods of aimed at detection of microbial antigens in the antigen detection is not that much useful, but determinations of ADA and interferon levels in pleural fluid may be useful as an adjunct test in the diagnosis of pleural tuberculosis. Next. And and in case of the utility of these tests in the diagnosis of other forms of extrapulmonary tuberculosis, that pericardial, peritoneal, and meningeal is also less clear. Next. The diagnosis of the latent mycobacterium tuberculosis infection is, I will take a minute here. In the year 1891, Robert Koch discovered that a component of mycobacterium tuberculosis is a concentrated liquid culture medium, subsequently named old tuberculin, were capable of eliciting a skin reaction when injected subcutaneously into patients with tuberculosis. But in the year 1932, Seibert and Munde purified this product by ammonium sulfate precipitation to produce an active protein fraction known as a tuberculin purified protein derivative, PPD test. But in the year 1941, PPDS, developed by Seibert and Glenn, was chosen as an international standard. Later, WHO and UNICEF has also accepted that batch of PPD RT23 and made it available for general use. The greater limitation of PPD is its lack of mycobacterial species specificity, a property due to large number of proteins in this product that are highly conjured in the various species, in addition to the subjectivity of the skin reaction interpretation, deterioration of the product and batch-to-batch variation limited the use of this particular test. But the skin testing with tuberculin is most widely used in screening for latent mycobacterium tuberculosis infections. The latent mycobacterium tuberculosis, for that purpose, it is very, very useful. But this particular test is again gives a false negative reactions in immunosuppressed patients and in those with overwhelming tuberculosis. False positive reaction may be caused by infections with non-tubercular mycobacteria and by BCG vaccinations also. Next. Very important interferon release assays, very important test. This is available nowadays in the market also, in the form of the Spot TB, next, are in the form of TB Gold, and the other tests are the interferon, QuantiFERON, TB Gold. These are all some of the tests which are available in the market. This you can, but these are also not the specific or not sensitivity and specificity of these tests are not up to the mark. So this but it will help to know that that's what it has been told, that they assume the probability of there's a high degree of diagnostic sensitivity than those of the whole blood ELISA test. Next one. Next slide. Okay. So in my opinion, after going through that, so Rajaxma may be correlated with the wasting disease, indicating, because Sanai Rupa Shushyate has been mentioned for all kinds of things, wasting disease, indicating suboptimum immune response or immunodeficiency disorders, involve function of the immune system, resulting in infections that develop and recur more frequently, are more severe and last longer than the usual time. Next. Next slide. Okay, so you know that immunodeficiency disorders impair the immune system ability to defend the bodies against foreign or abnormal cells that invade or attack it, the bacteria or virus or cancer cells, result usual unusual bacteria, viral, fungal infections or lymphomas or other cancers may develop. So people usually have frequent, unusually severe or prolonged infections and may develop an autoimmune disorders or the cancer. Next. So the recent, the latest studies are also indicated that the principles of Raja Eczema management for COVID-19 may be adopted. So the COVID-19 may be effectively managed by the adapting the principles of treatment mentioned for the Raja Eczema. Next. So there are some studies are also indicating that Bhrungaraj Asava as Naimithik Rasayana in the Raja Eczema patients, pulmonary tuberculosis, where the patients were given the DOTS plus Bhrungaraj Asava 30 ml thrice a day. And then it has been found that the patients treated with DOTS plus the Bhrungaraj Asava has given more good results with less minimum side effects. Next. clinical efficacy of agrarhythmic avaleha in the management of chronic bronchitis also. This has been Ayurveda in case of Raja Eczema, it has been avastika chikitsa has been mentioned. So in that way, this agrarhythmic may be useful in the management of the tuberculosis patients. Next. Next one. Okay, the adjunct therapy of Ayurvedic medicine with anti-tubercular drugs in the therapeutic management of pulmonary tuberculosis is, so there have been reported studies that along with anti-tubercular drugs, ashwagandha and multi-herbal formulation that Chyawanprasha has been tried, those two in ashwagandha and Chyawanprasha has given very good, very encouraging results. Along with the anti-tubercular drugs. Next. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide. Okay, very important. Okay, this is also again indicate that management of pulmonary tuberculosis, there are a lot of studies have been published. Next one. Next study. Next slide. Okay, this is very important. Silajitu Rasayana in patients with HIV infections. Yes, the patients who are suffering from the HIV infections, that those patients were treated with this along with antiretroviral therapy plus added with Silajitu has been administered to the patients, and it has been noticed that the patients got very good results. Next. It is very important is the clinical efficacy of sataputa abraka bhasma along with the chausasti pipali as an adjunct to AKT in the vacant pulm. Very important study. This is a very important study. It has been told that so to enhance the efficacy of the drugs, so then along with DOTS, you should give the sataputa abraka bhasma and chausasti pipali was comparatively better and in compared to the patients who are treated with only DOTS. Next. It enhances the efficacy of the anti-tubercular drugs. Next. Thank you. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. So now it is open for questions. If anybody wants to ask the questions, you are welcome.
Thank you, sir. Hello, sir.
Okay, Pooja, now it is open for question now.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful session, sir.
Thank you, Pooja.
Sir, as there are no questions in the comment box, sir, I have one question.
Okay.
Sir, what is AFB negative tuberculosis infection, sir?
See, you have to identify that if there will be an AFB positive and AFB negative tuberculosis test. Okay. So if the AAP is negative, then you would go for other test, you know, like the classical presentations of the clinical presentations are there or not. That is an evening rise of temperature, you know, that classical presentation is there at night sweats. There will be an associated with fever and there will be a reduction in the weight. That classical presentations are there or not, that you have to and with the history of the, if it is a pulmonary tuberculosis, there has been cough, history of cough, associated continuous cough that will resulting into the rupture of the blood vessels and then leads to the hematitis also. That also needs to be taken care when you are taking the hepatitis, and that AB is amount of accountable only for pulmonary tuberculosis. AB is useful only for that. If it is AB negative but associate, if it AB is negative, that's the reason sometimes if the sputum is coming out fine, if it is not coming, that's the need. I told saline induced these things, we are trying to induce these sputum, and then if it comes out, then it has to be collected. So then that test has to be repeated because you cannot deny that only by presence of the sputum negative. A sputum for AB is negative, we cannot say that the person is free from tuberculosis, pulmonary tuberculosis. But if the other presentations are there, especially the chest X-ray findings, ESR is raised, night sweating is there, evening rise of temperature is there, reduction in the weight is there, continuous coughing, these presentations are there, definitely then you have to start the anti-tubercular drug. The patient responds well with 1 month therapy, then you continue the same treatment, the four drug regimen for the 2 months and the two drug regimen for another 4 months. So total 6 month duration treatment has to be started for a normal healthy individuals. But if the patient is immunocompromised and if the patient is children or with old age person or with suffering from other immunocompromised condition, then the duration of the treatment may be extended.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Sir, as there are no questions in the comment box, I request our beloved principal, ma'am, Dr. Sayyed Atil Fatima, ma'am, to acknowledge the session, sir.
Yes. Hello. Shall I leave
sir.
The session?
Hello.
Okay. Okay.
No,
shall
sir.
I leave the session? Okay. Okay.
Good afternoon, everybody. Am I audible?
Yes, madam, it's audible. Namaste,
thank
madam.
You so much, sir. Namaste, sir. Extremely sorry, I could not listen to your talk actually because of my various official commitments, sir.
Okay, okay.
I'll go through the YouTube. Okay. Professor Parmeshwarappa is Badgi, right, sir? Head of the department, Department of Rogavidana and Vikruti Vignana.
Yes.
And I know that you are author of Ayurveda Vikruti Vignana, sir.
Yes, yes.
I could just hear few of the ending session. I could hear actually. Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invitation and enriching our student with your knowledge. Actually, we're very happy. Thank you so much. I think my dear students, they had a wonderful session. I think it was very rewarding and helpful also. Dear students, today actually, I don't know, somehow it was through NEMA, we had conducted one blood donation camp today.
Okay.
From NEMA, okay. Women's Wing. So okay. Morning also is quite busy actually. Actually, okay. This subject is very interesting for me. Somehow being Shalya Tantra department, I was heading the department of Shalya Tantra in Bangalore and even in Mysore. Rajakshma, basically, like whatever we have studied during our college days, that's it.
Yes.
My dear students, as you all know, this March 24th or 24th to a whole week, I think, the world celebrates its tuberculosis day. This is just a global cause to global call to raise awareness amongst the public. At the same time, to celebrate the success. I'll tell you why I am telling celebrate the success, and also this is just to remind the world that still tuberculosis is the number one infectious disease. In spite of all the measures taken by WHO. In spite of all the guidelines followed, in spite of the strategies they have done, still today, tuberculosis is a number one deadliest disease and is a killer disease. Why we want to celebrate? Because to certain extent, we need to celebrate today because probably so many lives we have saved since 2020, probably 2000. In the past 20 years, almost by following the WHO guidelines, probably we have saved worldwide 63 million lives as per the statistics available. Still then, almost 4,000 people die in our country and probably 28,000 people fall sick with this tuberculosis. It's now... the treatment is very, very effective. It is a very preventable and it has been controlled. But what is the reason in spite of that tuberculosis cases are going high? Because for me, I think it is the delayed diagnosis. The people will not go. They think that it is a simple cough. They keep trying medications till it has entered into from mild to moderate and it has become chronic. They don't go to the doctor. So the problem is late diagnosis, and the second thing is they'll not continue the treatment. Once there is no awareness, there is no seriousness about what happens if they stop the treatment. Because of this, I think the mortality and the morbidity of disease is increasing nowadays. The other thing about this disease is the risk of transmission. It is much. The risk of transmission is much. And the second problem is drug resistance. We have multiple cases of drug resistance of tuberculosis. Actually, this disease is very cost effective. The treatment intervention, the medical intervention has become very cheaper. Actually, the thing is that tuberculosis should have been eradicated by this time by the measures that have been followed. But it's not happening. It is not happening. Because I think the drugs they are giving, they have a lot of side effects. Probably they are hepatotoxic, maybe it is anorexia or something like that. People hesitate to take this medicine because of the long-term treatment. They will discontinue maybe because of that long-term duration or maybe because of the side effects. So I think definitely Ayurveda has a role to play. When Ayurveda treatment is given as an adjuvant therapy in tuberculosis, naturally it will help. No doubt that anti-tuberculosis drugs cannot be stopped. Along with that, we need to see to it that Ayurveda treatment should be given as adjunct therapy to see to it that there won't be any side effects and quality of life of the patient improves and the immunity of that particular person improves by parallelly giving the Ayurveda therapy. For me, Rajayakshma, I'll say for my students, don't ever compare this to pulmonary tuberculosis directly. It is, for me, tuberculosis is a syndrome actually, because even Charaka, I think, has discussed this in Nidana 8th chapter and Chikitsa, Charaka Chikitsa 6th chapter. He has given multiple this Purva Rupas, like Tri Rupa, Shad Rupa, and Ekadasha Rupa. For me, it is nothing but, Tri Rupas is a initial stage of tuberculosis, Shad Rupa is moderate stage of tuberculosis, and this 11 Rupas, whatever has been told, it is the chronicity of the disease. When you see that symptoms in these Rupas, it is nothing but it is a group of symptoms or diseases. So when you want to compare Rajayakshma with pulmonary tuberculosis and Rajayakshma, it is not said, only said. I need to say, you have to understand what is Shosha is all about. You want to understand what is this Kshataja Kasa. All this should be incorporated while treating Rajayakshma. Rajayakshma is not just plain tuberculosis. Our plain tuberculosis should never be treated on the lines of Rajayakshma. You have to think about Kshataja Kasa. You have to think about Shosha. All these things you need to take into consideration while treating this Rajayakshma. Right? You know that there is Aniloma, Kshaya, Pratiloma, Kshaya. All these things I think sir has elaborately has discussed. Even Bullu sir has thrown light on this. What I want to say is, just to end this, I want to say, we know when you give rifampicin and all, there is hepatotoxicity. So little bit of we have to take care of Agni, and we have to give some medicines which improve the Agni, some medicines which stimulates the functioning of the liver. Parallelly, you have to give some rasayanas. That adjuvant therapy will surely help to improve the quality of the patients who are undergoing tubercular treatment. Another thing is, this day should be celebrated to create awareness among the public that what are the things that hindering the progress of this eradication, what are the things that hindering? When this COVID, present COVID also, since 1 year, maybe that also has effectively hindered the progress of eradication of this tubercular disease. There are so many factors which are hindering the progress of this eradication. This type of, this day should be taken as clearly to give a call or to remind the public that still it is a number one infectious disease. No, we should never neglect cough or a fever of unknown origin, or cough and anorexia and weight loss should never be neglected. It should be screened as early as possible, because early diagnosis and adequate treatment, surely we can cure tuberculosis. This is the prime area, and this day should be given due importance, creating awareness on these particular lines. With these few words, as a head of the department or principal of Taranath Ayurveda Medical College, I congratulate the team of Kaya Chikitsa and the HOD for arranging this wonderful session, inviting the scholarly person, giving justice to this particular day. Thank you, sir, once again, wholeheartedly. Thank you.
Thank you, madam.
And sharing your knowledge with our students.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, sir. Thanks, Reesara.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Very good.
Thank you.